All right. We're going to look at the dictionary example that we talked about last week. And we're going to look at it a couple different ways. What I mean by a couple different ways is a couple different ways of exchanging the data from the server to the client. In other words, if you remember in our diagram, client server, the initial request is made, and the response is a web page. When we get into Ajax, though, we get another kind of request, an XML HTTP. And that XML HTTP is kind of misnamed, because so far we've been doing these, but we haven't been using any XML. All right, so that is slightly a misnomer. All right, but the difference is between this and the other sort of request is we are not asking for a complete web page. We get a piece of data. And we get that as part of the response text, at least we have so far, have gotten it as part of the response text. I suppose the simplest form of response could simply be a single value. In other words, we return, well, you would have had that for the current, not the currency, the tuition calculation. You make an Ajax request, it just returns a value. It's one value. The value is in response text. Another choice is delimited data, and we've also done some examples of those. Where the data comes in response text, we have to process the data a little bit, though, before we can use it and output it. In the case of a single value, the response text is the value. We don't have to do anything. Boom, there's our answer. In the case of delimited data, like comma delimited or tab delimited, we have to do a little work. We have to parse it and break it apart and so on, and then we can format it and display it. So this takes more processing. I'm using the word parsed. Parse is when you look at a big chunk of data and break it down into its components, break it down into its pieces. A third way of sending data back, these two really are the same way, so we'll count that as one, all right? JSON's the second way of doing it. JSON stands for JavaScript Object Notation, and it uses the style of JavaScript objects, but it doesn't exclusively deal with JavaScript. It's a data format. It just happens to be the name of it. And this has to be processed as well. It's a different sort of processing, but it gets processed as well. All right. And then finally, XML is the third method. And that, of course, has to get processed. Now, one difference is, if we are using XML, the data is coming back in a different place. It's not coming back in response text, it's coming back in response XML. All right, it's a piece of XML data, and it has to be broken apart. Now, we'll talk about JSON, we'll talk about XML in more detail. I don't know if that will be today or next week. But these are different formats. But what I'd like to do is give an overview, sort of how these different things, what the relative strengths and weaknesses of these different things are. Because if you look at this, you have three ways of doing it. Well, why would you pick one way versus the other? All right? It's important to know those things so that you can, when you have a problem like this, you can figure out what's the appropriate solution for it. So our choices are delimited data, JSON, and XML. Further down the line we go on this, the more complex we get. Alright. Now, what do you suppose that means when I say that's more complex than that? Requires more knowledge how to use it, requires more work to parse it, all right? And yeah, you have to have the knowledge to do the work to parse it, all right? So it's harder to parse. It's harder to create. Remember, with Ajax, we're doing work on the client and the server side, so we have to serve up this data in a particular format. The client has to accept the data in that format and do something with it. So, more complex, it's harder to parse, harder to create. Well, the logical question is, why then would anyone use XML if it's the hardest one? Your life is lacking challenges and you want to prove yourself that you can do it, or... Most efficient? I don't know if I would say most efficient.
Why would you use it?
Well, because it's the most something. It's not the most efficient. I guess we had would have to sit down and argue what we mean by efficient. There's probably a better words for it. Go ahead.
Oh, isn't the big thing about XML is that you can create your own custom tags?
That's true. With XML, you create your own custom tags, and we'll see how
gives you the most control.
Gives you the most control, gives you the most flexibility. Most flexibility. Most robust, I guess we could call it. Most powerful. Yeah, that does kind of look like you went to the gym to work out. All right. Delimited data is good in representing simple, homogeneous data, where every piece of data is the same. Like, for example, in the quiz that we did. In the quiz, we had a bunch of yeses and nos. That's all we had. We had as many as there were questions, we had a Y or an N, and it was separated by a comma, I think. So it was comma delimited, and we had Y and N. Every piece of data was like every other piece of data, simply represented what was the result of the question. Was it correct or incorrect? That's a perfect kind of thing for delimited data. All right? There's no structure there. It's not like there's nesting that underneath one thing was something else, you know. It's just a series of simple data, all right? I'm going to talk about this end, I'm going to talk about that end, and know that JSON is in the middle. JSON gets, like, the advantages and disadvantages of both, right? It's sort of halfway in between. It's not as complicated as XML, but it's more complicated than delimited. It's not as flexible as XML, but it's not is more flexible than delimited. So JSON fits right at the end of the continuum. What can we do? What would be something maybe that we could do in XML that we could not do using delimited data?
Like
queries from a database, you could do that in either, although XML might offer some advantages there. XML is good for representing a hierarchy of data and representing structure. All right? In other words, a series of yes or no answers to a quiz, whether it's correct or incorrect, there's no hierarchy there. Boom. There it is. All right? Whereas if we were writing a library application where we were searching for materials, all right? We could be returning something like this. Here's a book. Book has a title. Book has a year published. Book has a publisher. Does a book have one author? No, book could have more than one author. So there could be several authors. Author one, and there could be information about that author. Year born, place born, year died, awards the author won. Other books? Excellent. And so on. Under publisher, we could have a whole set of information about publisher. The name of the publisher, location, and so on. We could have editions of the book. In other words, there's a first edition, a second edition, and so on. There's a hardcover, then there's a paperback, and so on down the line. So we see here we get a whole slew of data. And it's not simply field one, field two, field three. There's actually a structure to it. In other words, this author information itself is a set of fields. And we could have multiples of these author fields associated, or blocks rather, associated with each book. All right? So we don't just simply have a list of fields in the case of a more complex Ajax transaction. We actually are getting back like a structure. All right? So David was close when he said a database. We can return data that resembles the structure of a database. Whereas delimited, we can return like a list of things. All right? It's probably the best way to put it. If all we were returning, for example, in this case, was a list of titles and call numbers, let's say in the library, then maybe we could use delimited for this. But if we wanted a rich description of the whole book and the structure and all the things underneath the book, then we would want to use XML. Because XML gives us the full range to do that. We, as David said, with XML, we create our own tags, similar to what you have in HTML. We can nest those tags to show ownership, you know, to show a hierarchy and to show a structure. Okay? So that's why we have these methods. You know, whenever you see more than one way of doing something, as you noted, all right, there better be some advantage to each of them. Otherwise, we could just cross it off the list, right? All right, if there was all disadvantages and no advantages, then we wouldn't even be talking about it, except maybe in passing. All right, but if we say there's several alternatives, well, the question then becomes, when do I use this alternative versus the other? And in the case of XML, HTTP requests and returning the data, the question is what's the nature of the data? Is it a simple list of data? Is it a hierarchy of data? If it's somewhere in between, then maybe JSON is the candidate. JSON's sort of the compromise candidate. All right, JSON, not as complicated as XML, but a little more flexible than just a plain
delimited file.
All right, so let's pull up the application and let's look, and I have three versions of this, each done with technology, each done with, one done with delimited, one done with XML, and one done with JSON.
Gonna look at these one at a time. I think we looked at the behavior of this, but to refresh your memory, this translates between English and Spanish mathematical terms. So as I start to type, it does similar to what Google does, and it populates my drop-down with a list of English mathematical terms that start with the character string that I type. I can then pick one, and I can hit the submit button and get the translation. Now, this actually makes two Ajax requests. One Ajax request is triggered by the typing in the text box. So as I type here, I make a request to the server to give me the list of words that match that particular string. Very similar to what happens when you do a Google search and you start but you get the idea. All right. The second Ajax request is when I go and click go and actually get the translation. And again, this is pretty simple. There's I don't know, a few hundred maybe? I don't know. Terms in the table. I forget exactly how many. But you can see this is something that, especially if you're going to extend this, instead of making a just a mathematical dictionary, if you're going to make just a regular you know, full English to Spanish dictionary, you would, it's not something you'd want to have go to the client completely, right? Because there's way too much stuff that would go to the client. You would want to have this bit of it live on the server. Chances are the terms would be stored in a database and so on and so forth. In this particular case, I simply make arrays of the things. All right, what I want to do first is I want to look at the results, all right? And I'm going to look at the server-side code for Delimited. And I can see that it's looking for the term word on the query string. So if I'm forming this URL, I'm going to type in the name of this page, so dictionary1.php ?word equals something. And that's going to be what gives me my results. So let's go and do that. Let's go in our browser. And let's type in dictionary1.php ?word equals A. That would simulate the request that gets called when I were typing an A in the text box. And there we have the values here. Notice that they come back each one of these being a value, each one of these representing a term. And there's two values for the term. There's the name and there's an index. The index relates to the position in the array. It's going to be needed when I go and do the request for the definition or the translation rather. Let's type in another letter. It's not always going to start with 0, right? It started with 0 because I picked A. But if I pick S instead, the number starts with 343. So the scientific notation is the 343rd term in the list. Okay? And again, I'm going to need to know that because spoiler alert, when I click this and click go, what I'm going to send back to the server is going to be the number associated with it. That will allow me to easily find that element in the array and output the translation.
You're sending only the number?
Sending only the number. Again, because there's a one-to-one correspondence to this. Each term has its own number. This will be the equivalent in database terminology of sending just the primary key, which if you want a row from a database, what do you know? You just need to know the primary key. You don't need to know anything else about it. Now, notice how this is. This is actually a little bit different than our previous example, like the temperature conversion and that sort of thing. In that, this file is delimited, but it has two different delimiters for it. It has a colon and it has a semicolon. The colon is used to represent and to separate the different results. So the first result is scientific notation, 343. That's the first one. The second one is called second degree, 344. Segment, 345, and so on. So the colon separates sort of the rows that are being returned. if you want to look at this as like being a table or like an Excel worksheet, each one of these things separated by the colon represents a row. The semicolon represents the parts of the row. That is, it represents the fields or the columns. And so the first column is scientific notation, which is the term. The second column, 343, is the index, all right, which we're going to need in making a request for the translation. So we're going to have to do a little more work than we've done in previous examples. In previous examples, we've done a split to split based on a comma or whatever, all right, when we were converting centigrade to Kelvin and Fahrenheit or whatever conversion we were doing. What are we going to have to do here? When we get our results, how are we going to have to parse this?
We could still use a split.
We could still use a split. How are we going to use a split?
We put in the character we want as part of the split.
Okay, so specifically in this case, what would we put in? Thoughts? The colon. Alright? That'll give us scientific notation 243 as our first element. That'll give us second degree 344. Then what do we do? Brittany?
We're still trying to call for the answer, right? Like we're trying to get to the definition right now? Or like it's already sent it back?
Well, we're trying to form the drop down now. We're trying to, as we type in here, as I type in an S, this is what I get back.
Okay, so once you have a split, you take the second half of the array and you send it to the server and say, find me the spot.
Okay, you're jumping a little ahead of that, all right? We still have to form this dropdown.
Oh, okay.
All right? So David said we split using a colon. So now we have that. Yeah, and how do we get to the first part of the array?
Could we set up two variables where the like answer index 0 is the first part and answer index 1 is the second part?
Right. In a nutshell, what we have to do is we have to split it again. All right? We're going to, first of all, split this big string, because this is coming back as one string. Is stored in one variable, response text. We're going to split it so that it's in arrays. Alright? And the first element of the array is going to be this. We're going to split it using the colon to split it. So that'll be the first element of the array. This will be the second element of the array. This will be the third element of the array. And so on down the line. Alright? We're going to have to split this again, all right, to separate the word part from the index part. And as we split that, we're going to do two different things with the two different parts. Remember, we're going to split this using a semicolon, and we're going to get the word and the index. What are we going to do with each of those pieces? The word part we put here, all right? What are we going to do with that index part? Make it its name? Good thought. What does a dropdown look like? Exactly. Exactly. Yeah, you are. A drop down looks like this. looks like this. And there's as many options as we need. All right. So, when we do the split of this data, each row that we get, each one of these pairs that we get, when we split it by a colon, each row that we get is going to become an option tag within the select. All right? The first part of each row that we retrieve is going to be the text that we show as the option, because that's what we want to show the user. Remember, when we have a drop-down, what is between the start and end option tag is what we're showing the user. The value attribute is what the server needs to do its job. And what does the server need to do its job? It needs this. Okay, so we're going to split this. Alright, we split the whole string into rows. We split each row, take the word, make it the option text. We take the numeric value and make it the value. So now we have a drop down that has as many elements as there are rows in our delimited data, and for each option, the text of the option is the first element of the row. The value for the option is the second part of the row. So, when I click go, what happens? It sends the value of the selected item in the dropdown to the server, and the server returns the Spanish translation. So let's look at this. Thank you. It's looking for the word index on the query string. So if I go in here and type in going to return the translated word. Alright. So, when I click it in the drop-down and click go, the value of the drop-down gets sent to the server on the query string called index, and the translation returns. Okay. Questions over any of this? This is sort of an overview of it. Not really looking at the coding yet, but just making sure conceptually we understand what happens in each piece.
Could I see that address bar again from the dictionary 2?
Yeah, dictionary 2, question mark, index equals, and then there's a value. And the value corresponds to the value of the index. Alright, we're going to continue to look at this backwards, or maybe inside out, by looking at the code for the server first. We're going to look at the code for these two requests to the server first. Dictionary1.php, Dictionary2.php. Dictionary 1 is expecting on the query string word equals with the number of characters that we're looking for. Dictionary 2 is expecting index equals with the index of the selected value. So, let's go and look at Dictionary 1 first. Alright. First of all, we have include dictionary.inc. And what do you suppose dictionary.inc is? Yeah, in our case, it's not a full-blown database, but it's an array. An array of all the different English terms and an array of the corresponding Spanish term. I actually created this by exporting some data from a website and put it in Excel and played around with it, so I didn't have to type all this in. There's no way I'd type in 414 terms two times, once in English, once in Spanish. These are what are called parallel arrays. What does a parallel array mean?
That would translate that as they both have the exact same values, almost like clones or twins of each other.
Okay, that's true. Can someone maybe put it a different way? Yeah, they're the same length, and each spot in the one array corresponds to, matches up with the spot in the other array. So, for example, if we were to count down the fifth element, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that's additive identity. If we go to the Spanish array and count down, it sure looks like Spanish for additive identity. All right. Now, again, keep in mind that we might have a database to do this, because it's sort of a pain making sure these match up, right? If I were to say I want to get rid of Taylor's theorem because someone came around and disproved Taylor or whatever, I have to remember to delete it from the English array and delete it from the Spanish array. The nice thing here is I only have to get it right once because it's in an include file. So yeah, it's a little bit of a pain, but I only have to get it right once. Okay, so I have my include file that is the two parallel arrays. I grab the value from the query string called word, which we already knew that because we looked at that. I assume that there's none. There's no results because that could be a possibility, right? If I typed in something really goofy here, no words match that pattern. So I have to handle that case too. So I'm going to assume that there's none until I find one. I then, excuse me, I then loop through the whole English array, right? Could I have looped through the Spanish array again? Sure, same number, right? Doesn't matter which one I get the count of because they better match up. Because if they don't match up, I got bigger problems than this. All right? So I loop through the entire array, starting I equals 0, incrementing I each time through the loop, and doing this as long as I is less than the count. I have this statement. I look for the position in the array element of the word. So this in turn is looking at each word in the array, is looking if the word is in there, and it's looking for the string position as a built-in function. What do you suppose that does? It's looking at the word that I'm searching for and the array element, and it's telling me at what position is the word in the array element. Alright? So let's Google that PHP function. All I like this. Find the numeric position of the first occurrence of needle in the haystack string. Alright? Here are some examples. Here I'm looking for A in ABC. Well, that's going to return a value of 1. I'm sorry, it's going to return a value of 0. I forgot we start numbering with 0. Now, here's a little catch here. To know that a substring is at the start of the string, you must use equals 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 0. Not making this up. Don't blame me. What is the reason for that? What does equals 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 mean?
Identical.
Identical. Why isn't 2 equals enough? Because false also, I'm sorry, false, I'm getting confused, this is so goofy. 3 equal signs is an exact match, including data type. So for example, true and false actually evaluate to a number. So if I test a number up against true or false, it's going to match if I use 2 equal signs. If I use 3 equal signs, it will not match. So if I said if 0 So, this is a good way to put it. Is A equal to B after type juggling? And what they mean by type juggling is type converting. So, for example, simplest example I can think of is... if I did that in an if statement, with 2 equal signs, that would return true. Because if I convert the string to a number, those match. They're equal. After type juggling. If I do this, that will not match. Because one is a string with a value of 1, one is a number with a value of 1. And in addition, Booleans also have values as well. So, bottom line is, this statement here is looking for it at the beginning of the word. All right? So therefore, if I type in an A and the term has an A somewhere in it that's not the beginning, it doesn't match. And what if it does match? Then I output the value of the array element, all right, and a semicolon, and then the value of the index. So I'm creating effectively that. And I'm doing that, I'm looping through the entire array.
So the print is saying the word is coming first and then the index?
A word, a semicolon, and an index. I also know, by the way, that I found one, so I no longer have none. If, however, I make it all the way through and B none is still true, then I output the dummy no words match this pattern and an index of negative 1. Is not looking at the letters. I is looking at the entries in that array. So I is looking first at, I for 0 is looking at the word absolute value, if I remember right. Okay. I having a value of 1 is accuracy.
So it's going through and looking and comparing each one.
It's comparing each one of them for each word in my array. Is looking at that word, and it's seeing if the strings that I typed in match the beginning of the word. So, in this case, it's looking for the position. So if I typed in AB, it would look for the position of AB, that would be in word, in absolute value, and then in arithmetic, and so on. A value of 0 indicates that it's there, and it's at the beginning of the word, which is what I want. I don't want it if it's in the middle or at the end of the word. So that equals a 0 indicates that it must be at the beginning of the word. And that's a keeper then, so I output that out. I loop through and look at the next English word. Does it match that string? If it does, then I have another keeper. If it doesn't, then I keep looping through until I've looped through everything. Now, if you're clever, you realize I could get out of this loop quickly, right? Because once I've passed the ABs alphabetically, I'm not going to get any more ABs because that list is in alphabetical order. But I didn't worry about that, all right? In other words, if I look at my list and my array, once I pass the ABs, there's no more ABs anywhere on the list because they're all in alphabetical order. But I didn't worry about that. Something like this that doesn't involve a database operation will go very, very quickly, and therefore to loop through 300 items is a minute amount of time, so I wasn't terribly concerned about that. All right. So, that's what gets returned back to the client. Our next step will be to look at the client-side code to verify, first of all, how it makes a request to the server, and secondly, once it gets the results, how does it parse that? And we'll take that up on Monday. All right? All these examples are up in Angel, all three of them, the delimited, the JSON, and the XML. And one thing that I hope to point out as we go over these, we'll finish up the delimited on Monday, and we'll look probably at the other two on Monday. The one thing I hope to show is what parts of it stay the same and what parts are different. All right? And we can almost guess what parts would need to change and what parts will be different based on what we have and how the client and server communicate. All right, that's all I have. We'll see you in lab.